approach it in a structured manner.
Right.
If you're really at sea and have no idea as to how to even start, sign up with a coach. There are so many today and so many for specific disciplines.
Right.
I would say always do that, because you know, it's easier to have someone do that hard thinking part for you initially, till such time that you get definitely more aware and you feel comfortable with juggling a plan around for yourself on your own. But having a structured, smart plan in place takes a lot of mind share.
Definitely.
And if you have the ability to get that from someone else, you should, because it'll come with a lot of invaluable stuff as well, just from in terms of experience, advice. You're not going to be reinventing the wheel. We all draw our inspiration from what we read or watch, or friends or people.
Right.
And you know, you think that, hey, if I should be able to, if so and so can do this or whatever, maybe I can do that much. And you know, I always maintain that as much as, you know, you are inspired by whoever it may be, you know, just keep your be aware of yourself as well, because everybody is different.
Correct.
And you know, what works for someone may not necessarily work for you, but there's no harm in taking inspiration and understanding and tweaking it to yourself. That kind of approach, which I've used for my running, my training runs, and now of course for the other aspects of my training as well, helps me. I apply similar logic to the other aspects. You know, I do something called a 3-2-1 list, and I, you know, put down the three easier things and the two that's going to require a little bit more mind share and a little bit more time, and the one big thing for, you know. So if it's like, if it's work and I have say 3 or 4 clients that I have to do work on, then I'll break it up into which are the 3 things that I can quickly get out of the way with them, which is the one client that needs the most attention today, and like that. Or then, you know, even with the kids and their school routines or home or whatever it is, or so I make my different columns and I just break things down, and then I'm like, oh, cool, done, just stick it up.
I am Baiki Binky, and this is the Working Athlete Podcast. Here, I talk to working athletes from all walks of life and experts from various sports to provide you with inspiration, training tips, time management, and lifestyle advice. If this is something that interests you, please make sure you subscribe to the channel so that you don't miss any future episodes. Today's guest is a longtime runner, a mom of 2, a communications specialist making corporate world a better place, and more recently, a triathlete who qualified to take part in the Ironman 70.3 World Championships based on her performance in her first 70.3 Ironman triathlon. Her name is Ketaki Agde Sade. So, welcome to the Working Athlete Podcast, Ketaki. It's great having you here.
Thank you, Venki. It's a privilege being on here. Thank you for having me.
What do you consider you? Are you a Mumbai girl or a Bangalore hoodie?
I know, right? I'm a total Bangalore hoodie at heart. But I have to say, I shouldn't be unkind to Bombay. I've been there nearly 20 years, and it's a city that has grown on me. And I mean, it's home for my children. So, but when I think of home and I think of a city that's my city, Bangalore.
Bangalore, so it is. You're born and brought up here? How is that?
No, I was actually born in Secunderabad. My father was in the Air Force and a test pilot. And the only testing establishment in the Indian Air Force is in Bangalore. So I think just by virtue of that, Bangalore has been home. I've done 9 out of 12 years of schooling here. Okay. I've done my college here. I've worked here. I'm also part Coorg, my mom's Coorg. So we have all our family here and Coorg. So Bangalore is home, and you know, my folks have dropped anchor here. And
awesome.
Yeah, so.
Great. And your Insta handle is The Hungry Runner. What are you hungry for?
Oh my God. So that is a play on the word hungry. For those who know me, they'll know. Just hungry for so much other than the obvious. I mean, I do love my food and I love cooking and creating in the kitchen, but hungry for knowledge, hungry for challenges, hungry for learning so much more in this space. So yeah, think that's where the hungry came from.
Awesome. You being Korg, you know, half Korg, so any favorite Korgi dishes?
Oh my God. You need to ask. Pandi curry. For sure. In fact, that's the first thing I just got into Bangalore barely a week ago, and Monday morning, my mom was at it making like a big handi of pandi curry.
Awesome. when did you start running?
Running for me started over 20 years ago.
So right about the time you moved to Mumbai?
No, in fact, I was living in the US at the time.
Okay.
We had moved to the US, and it was around that time, I think, all the good foods, you know, I started noticing the scales kind of going a little the other way. And I just, you know, started out with a gym in the complex that we were living in, and tentatively got onto a treadmill. And I think from there, I started running outdoors, and there was really no looking back. And this was like over 20 years ago, right? So I'd already worked and stuff, but I think those were the days, at least, back in India, like from 98 onwards, you know, like gyms that I think just started up, and people were going to gyms, but the whole awareness about fitness as a lifestyle and fitness in general was not, it was there to an extent, but it was not the way it is today. And so, you know, I think for me, that sudden discovery of just the outdoors and enjoying it happened in 2000. Yeah.
Okay.
And that's where I started. You know, it was like a small couple of kilometers, and then 5K, and then 8K. And then that just became part and parcel of everyday routine. And, you know, about 8 kilometers three times a week, threw it in with some, you know, aerobics classes and kickboxing and things like that. And that's where the journey started for me.
Right. In the US.
In the US. Yeah.
Okay. When did you come back from the US?
2002.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, end of 2001, 2002. Yeah.
And into Mumbai.
Yes, and then moved straight to Mumbai. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. And so there you started your journey in US and came to Mumbai. How was it different there and here?
Oh my God. So for me, Bombay was a culture shock. Not so much from the point of view of moving back from the US. You know, my yardstick was always Bangalore, and just, I think, so much more. Bombay is a different animal altogether. You know, it's just this, the numbers of people, the humanity, the disparity, the cramped spaces, the overflowing traffic, you know, all of those things hit me so hard. It was, I had been to Bombay before on holidays and, you know, in college, and it was such a great city, so fun. And but, you know, moving to the city and living there was, and of course, you know, my life state was also different, right? I was not in college and I was not working. You're setting up home and you're, you know, it did take me a while to wrap my mind around just the different dynamics and weather. I had never experienced weather like that ever before. Like, you know, I remember coming out of the shower and thinking, I'm sweating, but I've just finished a shower. How can I be just dripping? This is not water, this is sweat. So there were so many different things that, you know, I just had to get used to. And so the fitness angle was the one thing again that gave me a lot of respite, but I never took to the roads or anything at that point in Bombay. We got ourselves a really nice health club membership, and I would go to the gym. I was very much a treadmill runner, you know, when I came into Bombay. But that was something that really helped me, I think, cope and adjust to all these new changes in several different aspects, you know. Right from, like I said, you know, I was always, I've considered myself from Bangalore, and you know, growing up with in the services background, you're used to so much more space and just, you know, breathing room, breathing space, not so many people all over the place. So, you know, just all these different aspects were I took a while getting used to. Then it was a new scenario with regard to work, and it was so lots of changes. So definitely took me a while settling into Bombay. But the running was my respite. It was my getaway. It was, and I think that more and more it became the one thing that helped me sort of just center myself and, you know, help me give focus to other things and just, I think calming to an extent for me.
Right. So, something that kind of centered you as you were dealing with all these things, all these changes around you.
Yeah.
Right. But from that, from being a treadmill runner in a health club, when did the transition to an outdoorsy runner happen?
Yeah. So, so that journey happened along the way. So I was, like I said, definitely a treadmill runner for 3 to 4 years after getting back into Bombay. I had, you know, my first child along the way. And then in that process, again, you know, like I said, that running was the one thing that kept me going. And after my daughter was born, a couple of years, again, you know, we even bought a semi-commercial treadmill for our home. And so that was like my comfort space, just to know, okay, I have the treadmill, anytime I can jump on. It was after my second one, actually, after my second child, you know, got into that toddler phase when I was like, okay, I can now leave him. And so I think what was happening was, although I kept up with the rhythm and routine of the running and my fitness, it was always being tailored around this one schedule and that one schedule and when the baby's asleep or when the child is, something like that. And after my second one was a little, you know, may have been barely a year or so. And that's when I said, okay, I'm going to get outdoors to structure my routine and give myself a little bit more priority. And that's how it happened. So, you know, I'd head out 3 times in the morning. And that's, I think, how the outdoor scene happened. And
So 3 times a week in the morning, you were getting out.
Yeah, so I had, I joined a runner's group in the area. My thought process was not so much to get me out to run, because that was something I was already doing, but it was more to give me that structure and a no way out. Like, I have paid for this. I have to be there. And that was the thought process with which I joined the group, but it gave me so much more. It was like this complete window to a world of information, of knowledge, of so much more. It was great because I came out of my little well, you know, and I almost, looking back, I was like a horse with blinkers on, you know, doing my thing in the gym, on the treadmill, with whatever little bits I would sort of read up on. But getting out there, meeting people, joining that group was really a mind-expanding experience, other than everything that it gave to me running as well.
Right. So, you kind of found a tribe for yourself.
Absolutely. And I have some of my very dear friends, even today, though we've all been now different parts of the world and haven't run as part of the group in so many years, we are good friends and, you know, found your tribe. And I think it's just, you know, you always gravitate towards people with whom you have not only that one thing in common, but, you know, just where there's a meeting of minds where you can have conversations. And it was so lovely to meet people who were like-minded.
Right.
And the best part was that we shared this common joy and passion for running.
Awesome.
So yes, it's found a tribe in so many more ways than just, you know, from the running aspect.
Perspective. Yeah. Definitely. And then, so did this, you know, finding this group, joining them and kind of training with them, result in you taking part in events and races and stuff like that? And how?
Oh, absolutely. I would think for sure that was probably where it all kick-started, because, you know, like I said, I was already running. I was a decent enough runner in terms of, you know, half marathon timing and things like that when I joined the group. But you see so many people. You see people you know, you learn, like I said, you learn as part of just being part of that group. There was so much that we did as a routine, you know, there would be a warm up and certain kind of stretches, and there'd be cool down. And then, you know, everyone has different levels of knowledge and awareness about this. And so, you know, that was, you sort of share in that, you gain in that, you get inspired to go out there and just sort of poke around and dig for information yourself. And, you know, that's where inspiration comes from for so many things that one does, right? Other people and what people are doing as well. And that's when, you know, it was, you know, people would talk about the races, about the big six, about these marathons. It's like, hey, that's, and I never considered that maybe I could or I should. And so that's how it definitely started. And then, you know, you sign up, you do a race, you do decently. You're like, hey, maybe I should do another one. And then you start thinking of different courses of elevation, of bettering your time. And so that's definitely, I mean, joining the group is where running from a more running versus racing, right, you know, that shift happened.
Okay. What was your first race?
You mean just a marathon or like the one that I would possibly have raced yeah, or something like that?
Yeah.
Which was my first race? I would say one of the Stanchart ones, probably.
Okay. You know, where was it a half marathon? Or
yeah. No? So, well, I think I would say Amsterdam, you could say, would have been my first race where I definitely went in for that half marathon saying I need to do a sub two.
Okay.
And I had to, like, in my head, I'd planned it, I'd written down strategy in terms of how I'd run it. Yeah. And so, yes, I think I would consider that my first race for myself.
Okay.
And I didn't want to squeak in under a two. I wanted to do a, in my mind, you know, what would have been a respectable sub two.
Right.
And so, yeah, so that was my first, I think, for myself.
Okay. When was this? when was it that you joined the group? And when was this...
So I think I joined Striders in maybe 2013, 12 or 13, and Amsterdam was in 14. I did Amsterdam in 2014.
Okay. 2012, 13.
Yeah, okay. It's somewhere around that time. I can't quite remember.
Right.
But 2014 was Amsterdam.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. 2014 was your first race where you kind
in
of...
In my head. I mean, I'd done a couple of halves already before that. But, you know, this was the one where I went in with a clear goal, timing goal for myself to know that I have to hit that number.
Okay.
I have to run it to hit it. And, you know, I trained for it. And then trying to figure out race strategy. And, like, that was the first half marathon I think I really... ran as a race.
So you kind of studied the course, pacing strategy in place, nutrition, hydration, everything, pakka, and then executed.
Yeah.
So what was your time there?
So my time over there was 1:52.
Nice. So that was your first sub two.
That was my first sub two.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Okay. So how do you think training or running in general help your work life or life in general?
I think the way it's helped me is it's helped me actually focus. I'm able to, you know, structure things. Sometimes, you know, we all have those overwhelming days where you're like, gosh, there's just so much happening. I need to do this, that. It just, you know, that the way I've approached certain training runs, or like, you know, those long, hard 36 kilometer runs or the 38 ones, and you sort of break it down into smaller blocks and, you know, say, okay, I'm going to do this block in this much time or pace. And then then it's easier. You don't look at the whole as this one big overwhelming chunk. You know, you've broken that run up into smaller blocks of paces that just progressively get a little more challenging. And then it's just easier in your mind. You go into it feeling a little bit more relaxed. And I think that kind of approach, which I've used for my running, my training runs, and now, of course, for the other aspects of my training as well, helps me. I apply similar logic to the other aspects. You know, I do something called a 3-2-1 list, and I, you know, put down the three easier things and the two that's going to require a little bit more mind share and a little bit more time, and one big thing for, you know, so if it's like, if it's work and I have, say, 3 or 4 clients that I have to do work on, then I'll break it up into which are the 3 things that I can quickly get out of the way with them, which is the one client that needs the most attention today. And like that. Or then, you know, even with the kids and their school routines or home or whatever it is. Or so I make my different columns and I just break things down. And then I'm like, okay, cool, done. Just tick it off and then shut your brain off and then attack it all tomorrow. So
awesome. So 3-2-1.
3-2-1.
Awesome. Awesome. So, but along the way, right, you might have, all of us would need some adjustments, some sacrifices to get all these, you know, flowing together. So what are some of the things that come to mind? What are some of the adjustment, the sacrifices, if you will?
You know, to have, like you're saying, probably have my fitness aspect and my kids and everything sort of work as a good, well-oiled machine, right? Well, there are a few things. I mean, you know, you sometimes have to take a call in terms of one tries to get in every aspect of what one perceives as quality of life, right? In terms of meeting friends and socializing and all of those. So some amount has, you know, you tell yourself that, okay, that there's that one day I can do stuff and that's about it. But yeah, I think maybe, you know, just understanding that, you know, there are certain things you can't really do as much in terms of, well, those Saturday night partying. But the thing is, to me, that the Sunday morning early crazy bike ride or run is actually more endearing. So that's not a sacrifice, actually.
That's the real party.
That's the real party. Now, how do you... So, but I have to say that I definitely try and make time for friends. And, you know, I'm also one of those people who believes everything in moderation. You know, I'm not very... anal about, say, if I have a race, I won't do this for like a week or something. And, you know, with all due respect to everybody and everyone's way of approaching their respective fitness and routines and goals, this is just the way I look at my mind. You know, I just feel like I really feel privileged and thankful to be able to I don't want to say indulging in a hobby, because no, I really work for it and work hard, but to have the ability to do that and have, you know, every other aspect in my life in terms of like my, you know, this is something I'm doing for my
well-being,
and I feel really happy I'm able to do it. But at the same time, I do value my friendships, and not all my friends are in the same space. So I do try and, you know, shift things around to like afternoons or weeknights. And yes, sometimes I do find myself exhausted because I'm trying to fit in every aspect. And then, you know, you have that. So I can tell, like, there's like a, you know, it's like a wave pattern. You know, you're going at a great tempo, and then boom, there'll be one week where it's like you're just crashing because you're so exhausted. So there'll be one particular week where, like, you know, I would have missed like a run or two, or, you know, stuff like that. But what do you do? It's just those are the, I guess, the travails of trying to keep so many balls juggling up in the air, right? But yeah, I think over the last 20 years, though, in this fitness space and journey, there has definitely been a shift. When you're saying how do you keep it all moving, and, you know, there has definitely been a shift, because I am a lot more serious about it today than I even was 8 years ago. And I think that is also a function of my kids being a little bit older, everyone being a little bit more independent. Everyone also, like my family, also knows this aspect of my life is important. They also are adjusting. They're also playing their own roles, albeit subconsciously. They're doing it. Everyone's sort of accommodating the other person. Like, my kids will always say, hey, go out and do your thing on Sunday. My daughter will be like, I'm making breakfast. So, you know, I'm not. So it's also, I think, a function of time, right? I mean, time has passed. The kids are a little bit more older. They see how much, you know, this means to me. They are happy that I can do this when and so I really I'm so thankful again for my family, who've been supportive as well, because I don't think it can happen if that support is not there. And so everyone is sort of working towards keeping this machine chugging along, in as seamless a manner as possible. So it's a little bit of things. Yeah, there's not so much socializing as such that happens that you probably would have before.
Right.
Honestly, I enjoy having the ghar ka khana way more than going out. So even if we're going out for drinks or whatever, I'll quickly eat and then go. And also my lifestyle, you know, when my we eat at 7 in the evening. So our dinner is done by 7:30 latest.
Right.
So just little things like that, make the difference. Yeah, I don't miss going out at all. I'd rather have a few friends over home now and again. That's what it is. Also, what's happened over the years is, I think it's accident and not design, but now a lot of the friends I socialize with are friends in this space.
Right.
So we all are, you know, slaves to that early morning wake up for a workout. So there's no conflict actually. For most of the path, there's no conflict.
Right.
So it's just sort of happened like that. It's,
yeah.
You know, you just, and the friends who are not in this space, you figure out different ways and means of connecting. So that's one aspect.
Right.
Work, yes, definitely. I try and ensure that I can wind up my work week Friday. There's nothing on Saturday. I am a freelance professional. I'm a communications professional and I freelance. So it's a little bit of this whole gig economy thing. So sometimes you can't really say, hey, I don't work on Saturday or Sunday.
Right.
You know, there may be stuff I have to do and I just try and juggle it in a manner where there's not much. Like you can see today, I came with my laptop to your place because while I was in the car, I had hotspot on and I was quickly finishing up some work.
Right.
That's the kind of flexibility I have. So I try and ensure that, you know, my chunk of my Saturday and Sundays, of course, completely off. So that's great. I don't know if I really answered your question.
So it is what I see it as is, you know, over a period of time, you gravitated most of the social aspects or social relationships in the fitness area. And also it's a teamwork, right?
Yes.
Making all the family around kind of edges. And
absolutely. And I have to say, you know, my entire family, extended family, everybody they're so supportive.
Right.
And, we all still do things together. Like on Saturdays, my son golfs. So we try and make one day on the weekends about just the family doing stuff together. So that happens, or take them on a trek or, you know, stuff like that. It's nice. Everyone sort of working towards it together.
Right. So now you said you have been more serious of late than compared to say 8 years ago.
Yeah.
When you entered Amsterdam and stuff. So
what
is your PB? Did it improve over a period of time?
Yeah, so my PB for a half marathon is
144, wow.
Yeah.
And full marathon?
Full marathon is 358.
Wow. So with more structured training, more rigorous training and all this, right? Injuries are kind of inevitable,
I would say.
So did you have any major injuries over the course? And how did you handle
that? Oh my God. Of course, injury is inevitable. And I think it's part of the journey. But I'll start out with saying that at the outset, injury is also very humbling. In fact, after Amsterdam, I had shin splints. So over the course of my running journey, I've had shin splints. I've had stress fractures. I've had a stress fracture of the heel bone. I've had a stress fracture of the tibia. I've had, I was training for Chicago, the full marathon, and I was running in Florida at the time. I twisted my ankle. I was running on the road. So I've had a sprained, twisted ankle. Currently, as we speak, I am recovering from another sprained ankle scenario.
Okay.
I was meant to actually run as part of a relay team for the Herculean Tri, which happened about a month and a half ago.
Right.
And Hemmings and Vinay were my team buddies.
Oh, okay.
So Vinay was doing the swim, Hemmings was doing the bike, I was meant to do the run. And literally exactly 3 weeks before race day, I was out on one of my so-called, it was an easy run day, and I was on my warm-up. And I think my foot went into maybe a pothole, and it twisted, and I fell, and I flew. So that's my most recent injury. I mean, I've had a twisted, sprained ankle, and so I had to pull out of the race. So, yeah, I couldn't do it. But, you know, we found a replacement, and these guys did end up doing the relay race.
That's good. Yeah.
Yeah, but so, yes, injury is... and, of course, even my, you know, biking and swimming has had me see injuries and issues. And so lots. I've had an Achilles issue. I've had an ITB issue. My biking, I've had a rectus femoris issue over here. And so it is. But, you know, it's like I said, number one, it's humbling. Number two, it just makes you so much more aware.
Mm.
And I think it helps towards your growth as an athlete.
Hmm.
In terms of being more mindful, in terms of, you know, holding yourself back, or in terms of not doing crazy, throw caution to the wind kind of stuff. Please, and I'm speaking for myself, you know, I'm 44, going to be 45. So I'm also like quite, you know, I want to do this as long as I possibly can, because what I'm doing, I enjoy doing it. And whatever said and done, you know, as you get older, your body doesn't repair itself as it used to. Your metabolism is not as great as it used to be. And so I think injury at every step of the way, I mean, I'm learning things about this twisted ankle differently as what I did when I had it 4 years ago.
Right.
You know, things are different. I have gone through multiple physiotherapists and doctors. And so, you know, again, you learn so much more about injury yourself that, you know, you already are aware, you know what to do, you know where the faults lie, you know that strengthening is a huge aspect of being able to keep up with your training. And in my case, that's one of the areas which I end up shamming on the most. It's the seemingly simplest, but I don't know why.
Right.
You know, not as disciplined about it as I should be.
Mm.
So I think injury has definitely been there.
Mm.
And it's also, you know, I think it's in a way been a reminder to me at those points in time where I have actually, and it comes up, why does injury happen? You know, you start looking at the whys, you kind of look at it differently, you know,
right.
It's like, it's not about, oh my God, this will happen and how do I get past it? I've actually, the way I now approach it is, okay, why, where is this stemming from and why?
Yeah, what is the root?
What
cause?
Is the root? Yeah. What am I not doing right
that
is leading to this? Ultimately, it's a weakness that got finally snapped, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So that is the approach. And I think what I'm really enjoying now is just being an athlete and being more holistic in my approach to everything. You know, it's not only get out there and try and get a faster run in. And, and you realize when you're doing the things you're meant to, like strengthening and doing the exercises to strengthen your bones or your joints, automatically the paces happen. If you do the right kind of training, the, you know, with the intervals and the tempos and the right aspects to training, the faster paces are the happy byproduct. It'll happen. You've just got to, you know, approach it with the, that's the way I'm learning and seeing it for myself. You know, nutrition plays a huge part in how, you know, the your performance.
Right. So when it comes to, say, you, now with you talked about how important the strength training is.
Yes.
Where in your current schedule does strength fit in? Say, twice a week?
Ideally about 3 to 4 times, but I'm hitting about 2 to 3 times a week.
Okay.
And so, you know, I am now in the triathlon space, Venky, as you know. So it's not only the running, but it's the running, biking, and the swimming.
Yeah.
Of course, swimming hasn't happened for about a year, but we're slowly getting back there now. But what I usually do is I'll fit it in the evening. Or say if I know I'm doing a trainer ride and I want to, say, run in the morning on, you know, biked out legs, then I'll do a strength in the morning, a bike in the evening, and a run the following morning. Something like that. So I fit it in the morning, and the upside about my, you know, the kind of work that I do and being a freelance consultant is that I work from home. So I do get down to my desk at sharp 10 in the morning, but I have till 10 and I'm not traveling out anywhere.
Right.
So I do have a comfortable amount of time in the morning to fit that in.
Mm-hmm.
I try and wind up my day by like 5:36 in the evening. So right. I have the evening chunk also to do something if I need to.
Right.
Yeah.
Great. So I wanted to talk about that. So the first time I met you was on a bike ride in 2018 before TFM. That was my first trip to Mumbai, by the way.
Yeah.
And before TFM,
yes.
Wanted to meet the Mumbai riders there. So I joined the TFM organizers to
yeah.
go and, talk to
yeah.
them and all that.
Yeah.
So that's where I met you.
Yes.
So when did cycling start for you?
Interesting. We come back to injury. So when did cycling start for me? So cycling actually happened very serendipitously. I was injured with one of my running injuries. I think I had shin splints at the time.
Mm.
And it was so bad, I could not even jog. That's how bad the pain was.
Okay.
But by this point, I was already, it was so much just getting out there and getting in that activity was so much part of my almost blood that, it was definitely getting me down that I couldn't get out. And as an athlete, I'm sure, when you're injured and you're down and out, it's just the worst thing not to be able to
right.
do something.
Yeah.
So that led me actually to buy a cycle because a couple of my run buddies used to just cycle as well. So I bought a really nice hybrid cycle and that's how my cycling actually started.
When was this?
Must have been 2015-ish.
Okay.
After Amsterdam, in fact. So 2014-15, around that time.
Okay.
Is when I actually bought my cycle. And I'd done I had cycled with them. We'd done a few 100-kilometer rides within the city, a couple of rides. But that was not, the cycling was not a constant. It was a great filler when I was injured and my cycle was there. And I was, taking good care of it. But cycling as cycling really started for me in 2017.
Okay.
And this was when I decided to actually give triathlons a shot. Oh. And the whole point was that I said, hey, I already have a bike. So what if it's a hybrid? I'm going to start with that.
Yeah.
I have my running shoes.
Mm.
I have access to a pool, so I'm good to go.
Right.
Sorry. And so that's how cycling from the point of cycling for triathlons began in 2017.
Ah, so it's the triathlon that kind of got you into, say,
more serious
cycling.
Yes.
So, but it's the injury that got you a bike.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So when was this triathlon Kida
planted?
Yeah.
So I was training end of 2016. I started training for a full marathon in Latvia, which was meant to happen in 2017 May, which I was doing. And around that time, I think it was early 2017. That's when, again, part of being part of runners and friends and someone who'd already done a triathlon, I think. And so that's how, conversations happened. And I was like, hey, why not give it a shot? It was also a time in my life where I wanted to cut back on the number of days I was heading out in the morning for a run.
Okay.
Now it's coming back to me, actually. So that's how it all sort of seemed to fit, because I said, okay, if I were to buy myself an indoor trainer, then I can bike from home. I don't need to head out four times in the morning. I can head out like twice on a Tuesday and a Thursday and then just one Sunday long run. So it really fit in with my plan of not wanting to go out for a run 4 days in the morning.
Okay.
I said, okay, so great. I'll fit it in like that. So that way I get, more time at home in the morning. And that's how it came about. And then I would squeeze in my swims in my lunch hour in the afternoons.
Right.
So that's how it all came together. And that's when I started. So I bought myself a trainer and I hooked myself up onto Zwift and Trainer Road.
Right.
And that was it. There's been no looking back ever since.
Awesome. So the And the first triathlon happened when did that happen?
That happened in 2017.
Okay, what was that?
It was the Kolhapur triathlon.
Kolhapur,
yes. And boy, was that an experience.
What was, how was that?
So for me, it was, wow, yeah. It was my first open water swim.
Okay.
Like, you know, in an Indian open water body and right. swimming. It was right. not like, you know.
It was a lake.
Hmm. Actually called a talab. It's in a talab called Rajaram Talab in mm-hmm. Kolhapur.
Hmm.
And that was the first edition of that triathlon.
Okay.
And I think sometimes, you know, when they say you're a rookie or ignorance is bliss, there yeah. can be nothing truer. Because I was like, okay, yeah, sure, I'll just do that. It's close by. I don't have to pack my bike. I can just drive. And so I did it on my trusty hybrid.
Right.
And the swim, you know, I signed up with this really fantastic coach, Kaustubh mm. Ratkar. And mm. So I did my first try over there. And like I said, it was my first open water swim.
Mm.
I froke out in the water. I mean, you know, I couldn't see below. It was murky before that. The buffaloes were being washed in there. I was like, oh my God. And sometimes at some point, you're like, why am I doing this? But you know, at no point in my mind was it an option to even like give up. That was like, that thought never occurred to me. So
right.
I flipped on my back and I did backstroke.
Okay.
I was the only person.
If you can't see the bottom, at least I can see
the
sky.
Top. Yeah, and I think, so it was a question of how do I calm my mind down and complete this? Because I was so broken out,
yeah.
you know, swimming the freestyle because yeah. of the murky, like I said, my first open water swim.
Right.
Couldn't have been a better training ground. So, you know, the guys, the guys in the dinghies and giving us support
right, right.
from the organizers, they were like, ma'am, nikal jao. And I was like looking at them like, what? It's okay. I was the second last person, Venki, to get out of the water. Like literally, I had the lake to myself.
Okay.
No issues.
Lake so, to yourself
all
and,
to myself.
And the buffaloes.
And the buffaloes. With blue skies as my view. So yeah, I finished the swim. And I made up time on the bike and I was one of the fastest on the run.
Okay.
So yeah, it was not too bad a finish. I think I did 3 hours, 30 odd minutes for my Olympic try
okay.
or something like that.
Mm.
And it was
Olympic
a,
is 1.2?
1.5 swim.
40
bike and
10K.
Half,
10K,
yeah.
right.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that was my first experience. Like I said, Kolhapur couldn't have been a better training ground.
Mm.
And after that, I had signed up for the Goa Tri.
The 2018.
And this is the one that's organized by Endurosport.
Endurosport. Okay.
And the Olympic Tri, which had already been happening for a couple of years.
Correct.
So, you know, like I said, Kolhapur was such a good training ground. I was like, there ain't no way I am going for another open water swim without having done some practice in that water body or something like
right.
that. So I went for a swim camp to the waters of Goa before, you know, and again, sea swimming is a different ball game. It's mm. not a lake.
Right.
So that was really good. The camp really, really helped me, you know, prep for the main race day.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I think again that's been great. And then most recently, just before the lockdown, I did a try in Nagpur,
okay.
called the Tiger Man, which was again in a lake.
Mm-hmm.
And my God, you know, when they say you have a journey and you feel like, wow, I've come so far, it was a great swim. I didn't feel nervous
hmm.
or anything like that. And
so your timings also would have
changed
yeah.
right? Yeah.
So
Nagpur,
from
3 hours,
25 minutes.
30, little over 30.
Yeah,
yeah.
To now?
So for the Olympic at Nagpur, I was at 3:11.
Okay.
3:10 or 3:11.
Okay.
Yeah. Nice. And I came first amongst the women all
nice.
Together.
Nice.
That was the Olympic distance as well.
Awesome.
Yeah. So.
And in 2019, you did the Goa Ironman 70.3. That
yes.
was your longest triathlon, right?
That was my longest triathlon.
So how was that experience training for
it? Fantastic. It was just a fantastic experience. Training was good. I kind of, you know, I trained with a friend who helped me out. I don't know why I meant to. And anyway, so long story short, I was training. It was a combination of the two of us putting training plans together. And so it was in Goa. I'd already done like, by this point, I've, you know, done an Olympic try in Goa. I've done a swimathon. So, you know, my whole thing was, okay, also whilst in this try space, through the years from 2017 onwards, I also said that, you know, I need to concentrate on some of the individual disciplines to just help myself train and get better. So TFN was one of those. In 2018, I did TFN as part of just being able to get more comfortable on a bike, different terrains, bike handling, all of that. So, and then I did a couple of, I did a swimathon in Goa as well, just to again get more comfortable with swimming in the waters, doing a distance that I know would have helped me for the 70.3. So by the time the Goa Ironman rolled around, I had already swum in the Goa waters a couple of, more than a couple of times. But this was in a completely different beach.
Okay.
Which was again great and challenging. And the bike course was also really, you know, it was, I think the Ironman Goa was, the course was seemingly simple, but very smartly planned and deceptive, because the swim was a 900 meter loop.
Okay.
Oh no, 950 that you had to do twice. So, you know, it seemed like, hey, pretty simple enough. The bike loop was three loops, and there was just one small sort of steep
kind of thing.
Barely a couple of hundred meters. And likewise with the run, for the most part flat, but towards the end of that, it was a 7K loop. So three loops of seven was the run course, and it went up against an incline. And why I say deceptive is, so it was on the swim was on Miramar, right? And the currents were, I think that's the point where the river sort of merges with the sea. And so there's a fair bit of current. So you had to literally swim out one way to go in a different direction. And on the way, and then for a part of the swim, you were swimming alongside the shore. And then coming in, you were not coming straight in, which would have been great because you would have gotten an assist. But you were coming in diagonal at an angle. So that was, again, a smart move on the part of the organizers because you're like swimming, you're naturally getting pushed out straight, but you had to come in at an angle. And it was, the other thing was that at least I think 200 meters before you actually hit that roundabout point or the finish point, you, your feet were already touching the sand bed. So, you know, there were points where I was like, should I run or should I swim it? And if I run it, I'll burn my quads. And if I swim it, it's like, I'm not moving because of this damn current. So like I said, you know, very smartly done. And there was so, also the swim was crazy. I mean, there were so many people. I have never had what they say, you know, that washing machine effect. And I remember starting the swim on the Ironman and there were just hands and feet everywhere. And I never, and I'm like, oh my God, did all my training just go to rubbish? Because am I going to DNF like right now? And again, now I, there was no flipping on my back. At this point, I was like, I better not be flipping onto my back.
So, no looking at the sky.
No looking at the sky. I was like, okay, girl, you've got to do what it takes. And I just, I don't know how I got through that first, but I must have elbowed people as well. And then it got better because once you started swimming alongside the shore, you know, it sort of eased out and opened up. But the second loop was also bad enough. And then the, I think I thoroughly enjoyed the bike course on the Goa route. And like,
but you were definitely not the last coming out of the swim.
No, sir. Definitely not.
Because you prepared yourself with more open water swimming, more swimathons, taking part in swimathons. And you got out pretty mid-pack or average.
I think I would have been more towards the mid to the mid. My swim is the weakest link
still,
for me. Still the weakest link. So I was definitely mid to bottom half over there. And yeah, I think the one thing that all the prep did for me was to strengthen my mind. And that I think is a big one. Because like I said, you know, I'm making light of it now, but it was a very serious thing. And in the first 100 meters, I literally looked up and looked around and I said, am I going to DNF? And then you pull that mental strength and reserve from somewhere and you tell yourself, you know, you didn't train for quitting and just do it.
One you have already done it. So you tell yourself that kind of helps, right? Like, okay, you are done swimathon, maybe like what, 5K or something like that?
No,
or
I did the 2K.
So you have already been there and done that. You can still do it. So that that kind of preparation helps mentally more than physically.
Absolutely. And just little things not like, you know, physically. Breathing techniques in the water. Because at that point, it was not about, I can't swim and I'm worried about the waters. At that point, there was so, I was being pulled. I was being hit. I was being, there was no way to, Venki, I cannot tell you, there was no place to move.
It's like clothes in the washing machine.
And there was that whole thing of you have to swim towards the right to actually move straight because of the current. And so it was kind of pulling out some kind of strength from somewhere to say, just get past this. It will get better. And telling yourself, okay, you know, now I'm not even worried about the open waters anymore. This is great. I can do it. I'm not scared. And just fight these people off. Do it somehow. You know, it was just talking to myself through all of that. And so.
This too shall pass.
This too shall pass. So just and get done with the damn swim.
I got out of the swim and bike and run. How did they go?
Oh, that was great. So you know, for my bike as well, I had... if you remember, I'm just going to backtrack a little bit. For TFN, when we did TFN and everything, I was not on cleats. I was not cleated. And I had tried cleats before and, of course, you know, had the customary falls. But I was one of those few rare cases where I actually cracked a rib on because of one of the falls. So after my cracked rib episode, I'm like, okay, cleats. Adios, ain't seeing you again. And I packed those cleats away and I was petrified of getting back onto cleats. So before, as part of my training and run up to the Ironman, I was like, I can't go into the Ironman on shoes. I mean, come on, I've, you know, if I really need to up my game and I need to get better, I need to overcome this fear and just do it. So that was a big one for me because the race was in November and I got back onto the cleats sometime in July or August. And I was nervous. I was scared as hell. And, you know, I'm already in my 40s at this point and I'm like, God, I can't break a bone. I need to be there for my kids. I don't want to, you know. So, it was, again, you know, thank God for great buddies and friends, you know, who give you that confidence and take that time out of their own training and say, no, we will help you and let's do these drills and the sharp eights and the one cleat on and the one shoe on. And so I had a, you know, one of my tri buddies help me with that, and which was so great because it really helped build my confidence doing several rides outdoors with cleats. And so for me, that was a big one to be able to have actually overcome that. And in my mind, where I said I have to do the Ironman with cleats, I never really thought I could and I would. But I actually, here I was now transitioning out of the sea, getting onto my bike in my cleats, which was a big deal for me at that point. But it was great because, you know, I had planned my nutrition and hydration and I, you know, put in little alarms on my Garmin for when I needed to hydrate. And so, like I said, again, bike course very smartly designed. And, you know, with the whole penalties and you can't pass. And if you need to pass someone, you need to have a clear distance. So all of those things were weighing in on my mind when I was doing the bike course. And all I remember throughout that bike course was just continuously yelling out, on your right, on your right, on your right. Because I just got on that bike and I was like, girl, now you just got to make up that lost time. So, and it was great to know that I think I did it, because when I finished the race later, my kids told me, they said, you know, we were tracking you on the app. And of course, my son very sweetly and inadvertently, Ma, you were towards the end on the swim. But, you know, when you were on the bike, you just started passing people. Your numbers started just going up there. So that was great. And again, the bike course was, you really had to be vigilant because they cordoned off one side of the road, which was then divided into the two lanes. And I think since, you know, there were a the participation at the Ironman was phenomenal.
Right.
And it was a combination of seasoned athletes, rookie athletes, first timers. So there were a lot of folks who were doing this as, you know, hey, this is a fun thing, which is great.
It was fun
for me too, but I was also in my mind racing it and trying to hit certain time goals, right? And then for me, in my mind, the bummer was, you know, at the top turnaround point when we had the descent, they were not allowed to pass people on so that was the thing where I think for a lot of people where you felt like maybe you could make up time on the descent, you were not allowed to pass for those couple of hundred meters and you had to just stay behind. So I remember feeling like a school teacher on one of the loops. I, you know, someone ahead of me was cruising and I'm like, come on, pedal, move it. And I'm like, I'm not going to see him again. I don't care. Because he was cruising and I'm like, move it. So he got really frustrated. Then he started pedaling. And so, yeah, my bike course was, I just enjoyed it. Like the 90 kilometers flew by in no time. And then came the run course, which was great. But and I, you know, I run in Bombay in the heat, and I've, you know, as part of my training and all of that, I've always run even in the afternoons in Bombay and tried to hit the paces and the numbers that I needed to. The Goa run was it was fantastic again, and that heat though, it took something else out of you, you know. But again, like I said, very smartly designed course, because just when you're hit going, you know, you're coming to the shaded part towards the Mears Bungalow, that's when you hit the incline. But it was a great feeling. And
did you pass more people on the run? Because
I think I did. I think I did. I was the first Indian woman finisher at the Ironman 70.3 Goa.
Awesome.
Yeah. And I was the second fastest on the run amongst the women.
So, and you won your age group.
Came second in my age group.
Second in the age group.
Yeah. Yes.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
And this earned you a qualification for the world championships.
Yes.
70.3 world championships.
Yes.
Which unfortunately did not happen.
Nope.
It was because of the pandemic.
Yeah.
But is there a chance that they would happen this year? Or
so, we were given options where we could defer our participation to a race this year in Utah in September, or next year, 22 December, back at Taupo in New Zealand.
Okay.
And I selected 22 December.
That's smart, I think.
Yeah, you know, I think last year when all of this was going on, for me, I was like, you know, I enjoy my training. Like for me, my training runs, my training bike rides are like, I go to bed feeling nervous and I wake up like, oh my God, will I do it? So for me, I enjoy the training, and I really want to be able to do this in Taupo. And I'm like, you know, I'm in no hurry to go for the event, but I want to do this where I wanted to do it. So I said 22 December and we'll see. Yeah.
Taupo is a great look. I mean, New Zealand is a great place.
Beautiful.
And I think even from the perspective of all the uncertainty that is still there, right?
Very
I
much.
Think 22 December sounds like
sounds like a plan now. It actually seems like, okay, I hope even 22 happens, because we feel like, you know, we're already halfway through 21. But yes, so 22 December, but in the interim, it's, you know, it's just been great training.
So how what was your time in the Goa try?
In the 6:20.
6:20. Do you have any goals for your top four?
I would love for it. I would definitely want to do a sub six. I mean, that was actually my goal even for Goa. But so that's the thing, right? You kind of look back, you reflect, and you're like, okay, what's doable? What's a good sweet spot between ambition and doable in a mindful manner? For me right now at this stage in my life, it's all about trying to do as best as I can in the most mindful manner possible.
And so
in fact, when the pandemic and everything hit, I couldn't have been more grateful to the universe for my sweet, humble trainer. And I said, this is a great time to start upping my biking game. And that's what I've been trying to work on, the biking, and just trying to get that, you know, better.
Right.
And I'm enjoying it. I am really enjoying it and trying to keep up with the run paces. And I definitely have a run goal and time in mind as well,
right,
which I'm working towards. So these are the two areas I know that at this point in the last 1 year, and at least for the next foreseeable several months, are the two disciplines that I can, you know, concentrate on in a sort of focused, nice, structured fashion.
Nice.
And yeah, that's what I'm trying to do.
Yeah, so this is something that what I notice from our conversation is that you, over the period you had that running base, and then you, when you decided you wanted to try, you made sure that you worked on specific aspects of that, be it the swimming or open water swimming with swimathons and stuff, and the cycling aspect with taking part in TFN and stuff like that. And I see a very measured, unhurried but structured approach, which is great. Now, talking of TFN, right, we can't go past without the episode without talking about TFN because I've done it so many times, and I just love that event. So how was it for you as an experience?
It was phenomenal. What are some of the memories? It was phenomenal. I have to give credit to, we all know Anand, who was the one to egg me on for TFN. And I remember telling him, are you kidding me? 8 days, 100 kilometers, back to back, I'm not there.
Yeah.
But again, you know, I decided to sign up. I signed up, and then it was about training for it.
Right.
Again, as best as I could. And so went into TFN having done a couple of 100 kilometer bike rides and Bhorghat and all of that in Bombay. Like I said, TFN was also pretty early in my journey as a cyclist, coming from a triathlon perspective and just as a cyclist. And also the year that we did TFN, 2018, I believe, and correct me if I'm wrong, that is the only year that they've had, they've seen the kind of participation that they saw in terms of the numbers, and they had the most number of women that year.
Most number of women, most competitive field ever.
Yes.
And the Hong Kong team,
over, and that's I still have friends from there. I'm so thankful for having done it that year, because we had the team from Belgium, we had the team from Hong Kong, we had the team from Denver.
Yeah.
And it was so fantastic. And that really, I came out of TFN feeling like a more confident rider, like downhills didn't daunt me as much. You know, just understanding how to gear, a little bit about gearing ratios and what works more efficiently. That was great. And being able to ride on back-to-back days for roughly 100 kilometers or so more every day was just really, really great. And to feel pretty okay at the end of it. I remember all of us would finish and have our beers in the evening and then back to it in the morning. So, you know.
So you got confident over the downhills and stuff.
Yeah.
How about the uphills? How was Kalahati?
Oh my God, Venkay, I think you know what happened with me in Kalahati. I ran up Kalahati.
Okay.
So yes, like I said, that was a time when I was still very young in my cycling journey. And I was, so Kalahati, so started the climb. And I think the moment you start stopping, it's just tougher and tougher to keep getting back, right?
Yeah.
And definitely I was not in the league or in the caliber to do that kind of sustained climbing.
Right.
But the one thing I had in my mind for that was just keep your feet moving. Don't stop.
Yeah.
So I didn't stop. Yeah. I held my bike and I ran. I think I ran at the pace that, like, I was running at a pace of like,
cycling. I think you would, you could walk and run at the same pace as the cycle.
Yeah. So I was, I did that and I was like, damn, I'm not able. So I got back on a couple of times, tried, quads are burning. Like, okay, get off. Keep those legs moving, move. I'm like, just run it, man. Just run it. You have shoes, you don't have cleats.
Yeah. So, that's the advantage.
That's the advantage. And the rules permitted, right, for Kalahati. So I just ran.
Yeah.
I just finished it running.
Awesome.
So, but I do want to go back, because now I want to do it on cleats, because I just finished a climbing race earlier this year.
That is Shahadri class.
Yes.
Oh,
yes.
Okay.
So,
nice.
Like I said, you know, the last year has also been about trying to focus on the things that sort of go into making you a good, well-rounded cyclist as well.
Correct.
And
the Shahadri Classic in Pune.
Mahabaleshwar.
Mahabaleshwar.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's what did you do? Do the two ghats or the four ghats?
I did the two ghats.
Right.
I think as you may have gleaned from our conversation so far, I err on the side of caution and I'm a little
definitely.
Bit more conservative.
Yeah. Definitely. Yeah. So, we need to look at the longer term perspective.
Yeah,
we are not going to hang up our boots
anytime soon, if I can
so
help.
So we
it.
Have the time,
yes.
Right? That's good.
Yes,
that's good.
Yes. So I said two ghats, which is 90 kilometers of 90 kilometers. Mm. So, you know, from the perspective of the distance, not a big deal.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we do that on our weekend long rides.
Right.
But this was not about just a 90 kilometer ride. It
right.
was an interesting one where you're climbing for
yeah.
most part of it.
Mm.
The Sahyadri happened right now in Jan.
Right.
And for us in Bombay, lockdown kind of eased up to an extent end of June, July onwards. And
right.
that's when, you know, we sort of tentatively started getting out there. When I say we, it's just me and two, three others in,
yeah.
you know, where we cycle together and stuff. So we would only meet up for our rides on,
right.
on the weekend.
Mm.
And we started going out on weekend rides.
Mm.
And then, you know, the Sahyadri was happening. And so,
mm-hmm.
so we, again, we, the four, five of us who bike together, we mm-hmm. decided to recce the route.
Okay.
And we actually took a weekend off in December
mm-hmm.
and did the entire route to just get a sense.
Right.
I had done this route in 2019, I think,
mm-hmm.
but slightly different one. And
mm-hmm.
I just remember it being like this exhausting ride because
yeah.
we did it in April,
right.
the afternoon. And so anyway, so, you know, the way we approached, so amongst my group of friends, it was only me and another one who actually signed up for this. Everyone
okay.
else came in for support and to do it because we
right.
love cycling.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we recce'd this route. We actually did a weekend in December where we recce'd the entire route and everything. It was fine. And so the race was great because you're actually timed only for 40 kilometers of climbing.
Yeah. Only the climb sections are timed.
Yeah, but even the first bit, they
mm.
time you only for 10 kilometers of the climb. You're
right.
climbing a lot more,
uh-huh.
but they time you only for 10 kilometers
okay.
of
certain
that
segments.
Climb.
Okay.
Yeah,
mm.
but the second ghat, they
mm.
time you for the entire
and
section of. So that's the really nice one where
mm.
you're climbing for
mm.
30 kilometers and
right.
you're being timed on that one.
Right.
So that was really great because it really helped me understand how, again, when you said, you know, how about climbing,
mm.
how I've come so far in terms of the ability to keep it sustained,
right.
how I fared in December vis-a-vis Jan,
mm.
what I'm feeling, how to tell my mind
right.
that, you know, how to overcome certain things, whether it's a, at that point, a battle of mind over legs or legs over mind or,
right.
you know, so it's been good. I am really enjoying the space,
mm-hmm.
Venky. And, you know, I think the nice part is when you're going into it with, I'm doing it because I enjoy doing it.
Yeah.
And I just want to do the best I can
nice.
For me.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's it. But again, smartly,
right.
because it's not to say that I'm not competitive or I don't like to do as well as I can.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah, I think the fun part is to be smart about it. And like for me, in my head, like
yeah,
plan
yeah.
it and to hit those numbers and then go back and see how I did vis-a-vis my previous ride. And,
right.
Yeah.
Excellent. So I had this one question asking, you know, you have started your endurance journey, say 20 years back. And while a lot of people start some activity or the other and get bored and give up or injured and give up and go back to playing golf or whatever. Some golfers are going to pay
yeah,
for this,
yeah.
but that is also. And no, but you have kept at it. But you have not only kept at it, but you have added more and more layers on top of it. And my question was, how do you keep it going? But I think we already partly answered saying that the doing it taking it one at a time, working at it, enjoying the process, getting better at it, and yeah. adding another layer.
It's like a jigsaw puzzle. It's like right. it's one of those fun things, right? And I have to say that I truly enjoy it. Like, right. I really love to go out and run. No, I'm looking sometimes when I'm really having a hard day at work, all I can think about is, okay, I'm just going to get on the bike now. I can't wait to get on the bike and see if I can hit those numbers on that interval. Yeah. For me, that's like, it gives me like that little happy high in my head to get through the next bit of work.
Right.
How do I do it? It's also about, I think for me, it's also about understanding and knowing my weaknesses, because then that becomes an interesting challenge area which you're trying to work at.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, jigsaw puzzle, because then it's like, okay, how can I put those pieces together? And, you know, like for me, and, you know, we all draw our inspiration from what we read or watch or friends or people.
Right.
And, you know, you think that, hey, if I should be able to, if so-and-so can do this or whatever, maybe I can do that much. And,
right.
you know, I always maintain that as much as, you know, you are inspired by whoever it may be, you know, just keep your, be aware of yourself as well, because everybody is different.
Correct.
And, you know, what works for someone may not necessarily work for you, but there's no harm in taking inspiration and understanding and tweaking it to yourself.
Right.
And so for me, like, why am I not bored? I'm not, because I know like there's so much I need to do.
Yeah.
Okay, I want to climb that and climb it at this pace, or maybe even a little better. How can I get there? What are the better training options, or the training plans, the routines, or the workouts? And now I'm also understanding there's a huge aspect that I have really been ignoring, and I really need to be a lot more aware and understand it better, which is the strength training aspect.
Right.
And I have seen value in it over the lockdown, especially.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you were restricted with literally not going out of the house, we couldn't even run. All I had was strength training and biking, and that was it.
Yeah.
And I saw my body change. I saw myself getting tougher on certain aspects. And it's really, and I'm guilty of shamming on that front. But like, again, for me, I'm like, okay, I have this huge chunk that I have to work on. So it's great. It's like this exciting thing for me. Like, okay, now let's
something else to
you know, sort of put into the mix and try and understand and work on. So yeah, it's just always about trying to just, you know, work out that challenge.
Awesome. So let's kind of, conclude this with some of the learnings that you had over the years that you can share with the working athletes listening to the podcast to do well at sport while doing well at work and life in general.
Okay, so what I'd say is, I can't seem to be able to get enough of the word mindful, but yes, you know, just be mindful of your body and yourself. I mean, start out with, if you're working and you're juggling your kids and all of that, and there's no harm in, you know, once in a year, once in 6 months, doing a first and foremost, like a good medical checkup. I mean, I know I've done that, and just to get a sense of where you're at, what your levels are at, whether it's your vitamins or your whatever, you know, to just get a sense of that. I think that's a good baseline to start with, to just understand where you're at medically, so you're not doing something or pushing yourself inadvertently.
Right.
You know, just get a sense of that. If you do have definitely certain issues like BP, or you are overweight and stuff, you need to consult with someone, a professional, and keep that person in the loop, because like I said, I can't get enough of this. You cannot take yourself or people, you know, you're valuable to someone else, and you value everyone in your life as well. You need to be responsible about how you take your fitness forward to start out with. So I think that's an important thing for all of us who are in our 30s and 40s, at any, actually at any stage, you know, it's good to just get a sense of your medical levels and, you know, benchmarks, and get that out of the way. And, how do you sort of juggle it, and just approach it in a structured manner. If you're really at sea and have no idea as to how to even start, sign up with a coach. There are so many today, and so many for specific disciplines. I would say always do that, because you know, it's easier to have someone do that hard thinking part for you initially,
yeah,
till such time that you get definitely more aware and you feel comfortable with juggling a plan around for yourself on your own. That's my advice and take, you know, and it's a big one because, you know, when you are juggling your work and your kids and your domestic life, it's having a structured, smart plan in place takes a lot of mind share.
Definitely.
And if you have the ability to get that from someone else, you should, because it'll come with a lot of invaluable stuff as well, just from in terms of experience, advice. You're not going to be reinventing the wheel.
Right.
You know, go through that initial journey with someone else, because there's so much you can learn from others.
Correct.
And that's my advice always, like, you know, sign up with a coach because you learn so much more than what you knew, especially if you're starting out as a newbie. I think that's important.
Awesome, Ketki. This has been a fantastic chat. Thank you for joining the podcast and sharing your journey with all the audience at the Working Athlete Podcast.
Thank you, Venki. It's been great. Thank you for having me.